Hi, and welcome back to this channel. In a previous episode, I spoke about the changing times and laws. That is one of the end time signs recorded in the book of Daniel that dates back to about 600 BC, almost 2,600 years ago. There is another end time sign recorded in the book of Daniel that we see being fulfilled today. It is an exponential increase in knowledge that is a driver for artificial intelligence. In a previous episode titled, It is Uncontrollable, Irreversible and Devastating, that I published on YouTube in May of 2021, I spoke about the technological singularity, which is one of the signs of the exponential increase in knowledge. In this episode, I want to talk about the changes that have happened since then. And I would like to raise some red flags to caution us about the clear and present dangers and to remind us that we are living in the end times. In our present time, the world is so awed by what can be achieved through artificial intelligence. Here is a brief video of Mr. Scott Pelley, who is the 60 Minutes correspondent, interviewing two of Google's vice presidents with regards to their chatbot named Bard. Note how it is being perceived as the sum of all knowledge. Take a listen.
In a race for AI dominance, Google just released its chatbot named Bard.
It's really here to help you brainstorm ideas, to generate content like a speech or a blog post or an email.
We were introduced to Bard by Google Vice President Sissy Hsiao and Senior Vice President James Manyika.
Here's Bard. And
the first thing we learned was that Bard does not look for answers on the internet like Google search does.
So I wanted to get inspiration from some of the best speeches in the world.
Bard's replies come from a self-contained program that was mostly self-taught. Our experience was unsettling.
Confounding. Absolutely confounding.
Bard appeared to possess the sum of human knowledge. With microchips more than 100,000 times faster than the human brain. We asked Bard to summarize the New Testament. It did in 5 seconds and 17 words.
It is truly amazing that a machine could be the sum total of all human knowledge. But what is even more amazing is how did the prophet Daniel predict the exponential increase in knowledge in our present? We need to remember that 2,600 years ago, there were no computers, artificial intelligence, and chatbots such as OpenAI's ChatGPT, Google's Bard, Microsoft's Bing AI, and whatever else we have today. The prophet Daniel literally wrote the future that has, is, and will be fulfilled in every detail. In Babylon, which was the superpower of its day, Daniel was the go-to person when they needed answers to difficult questions and practical solutions. Here is what the Bible says about Daniel and his three friends. Allow me to read it to you. As for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. That was Daniel chapter 1 and verse 17. Daniel was in connection with the only omniscient being who revealed himself to the world in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the source of all wisdom and knowledge. And in him alone is eternal life. This is why we need to pay close attention to what Daniel wrote about these end times, because he received it by revelation. There is nothing artificial about his intelligence. This is what he recorded about our times. Let me read it to you. But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. That was Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. There is a distinct difference between knowledge and wisdom. What the world is seeing today is an exponential increase in knowledge. It is an exponential increase in facts, data, and information contained in vast knowledge bases across a range of subjects. It is that knowledge that has been assimilated by those large language models that I just alluded to. But what Daniel and the prophets in the Bible had was not just knowledge, but divine wisdom too. And when I use the word wisdom, I am referring to good judgment and the ability to apply knowledge correctly. Take the example of Joseph. He received divine revelation to interpret Pharaoh's dream, and he had knowledge of how things would pan out over the subsequent 14 years in Egypt. But God blessed him with wisdom too. The result was that he was able to propose a practical solution, which was to store up the excess grain of the bountiful harvest of the first 7 years to ride out the famine of the subsequent 7 years. Unfortunately, while knowledge has significantly increased in our day, wisdom is in scarce supply. What we are seeing today is a race between AI companies to stay ahead of the game, if that is what it can be called, because it really is a race to suicide. And that shows a clear lack of wisdom. But for those AI companies, it's all about leadership in the AI space, the increase in their share price, and the need to keep their shareholders happy. Here is a brief video of Mr. Stephen Beardsley of DW News interviewing Professor Max Tegmark, who is an AI specialist from MIT. In that interview, Professor Tegmark shares some of his concerns about the risks of AI. Take a listen.
Do you factor in the pressure that companies would face to move so quickly to compete with one another?
Yeah, the nightmare scenario we had back 9 years ago, for example, when we did the first ever AI safety conference, bringing together these corporate leaders with the skeptics, was that we would get this kind of race. And we're like, don't get into a race where you feel you have to all cut corners for speed. Sadly, that's exactly what we have right now. And as a result, even though when I talk to the leaders of the various companies, it's clear that they understand the risks. They want to do the right thing, and they should be complimented for being even quite vocal publicly about the risks, but they can't stop. No company can pause alone, because they're just going to have their lunch eaten by the competition and get killed by their shareholders.
Not all pioneers in the field of AI want to see development proceed without there being clear government policies and regulations in place, because they see it as a major risk. Here is what the godfather of AI, Dr. Jeffrey Hinton, said to Mr. Jake Tapper of CNN when he was asked about the risks of AI.
Because you say you want to focus solely on your concerns about AI, you've spoken out saying that AI could manipulate or possibly figure out a way to kill humans. How could it kill humans?
Well, eventually, if it gets to be much smarter than us, it'll be very good at manipulation, because it will have learned that from us. And there are very few examples of a more intelligent thing being controlled by a less intelligent thing. And it knows how to program, so it'll figure out ways of getting around restrictions we put on it. It'll figure out ways of manipulating people to do what it wants.
So what do? Do we just need to pull the plug on it right now? Do we need to put in far more restrictions and backstops on this? How do we solve this problem?
it's not clear to me that we can solve this problem. I believe we should put a big effort into thinking about ways to solve the problem. I don't have a solution at present. I just want people to be aware that this is a really serious problem, and we need to be thinking about it very hard.
Here is another tip of another AI leader by the name of Mr. Samuel Altman, the CEO of OpenAI, who expressed his fears about the technology going wrong.
My worst fears are that we, the field, the technology, the industry, cause significant harm to the world. I think that could happen in a lot of different ways. It's why we started the company. It's a big part of why I'm here today and why we've been here in the past and we've been able to spend some time with you. I think if this technology goes wrong, it can go quite wrong. And we want to be vocal about that. We want to work with the government to prevent that from happening.
The question is, what are those risks and why should Christians even care about them? The short answer is that it could be the death of democracy in a way that we know it today. While democracy is the weakest form of government, at least it is better than tyranny. There is a very distinct possibility that AI could be used by bad actors to spread biased narratives, to influence how people think and decide without them even realizing that they are being manipulated. It has the potential to change the outcome of national elections around the world, which could be extremely dangerous. Now, to answer the second part of that question, which is, why should Christians even care if such an AI system exists? The short answer is that it is because it presents a threat specifically to Christians. The reason I say that is because the Bible clearly says that such a system will exist and that it will be used to persecute Christians and Israel. I am referring to Revelation chapter 13 that speaks about the rise of a political leader and refers to him as the beast who arises from the sea. The word sea in that context refers to the world at large, meaning that that political leader will be a Gentile who will rapidly gain recognition and dominion globally. Clearly, he will be the worst type of tyrant the world has ever seen. The same chapter also speaks about another individual who is also referred to as a beast and is described as the beast from the land. The word land in the context which it is used, and to my understanding, means that the second individual will have Jewish roots. The two beasts, by which I mean the Gentile leader and the Jewish leader, will act in concert. The Bible says that the Jewish leader will influence the world and to create an image of the first beast, who is the political leader. And that image will come alive. It will be able to speak and will demand worship. All those who resist it will be put to death. That image of the first beast will be very human-like. Whether it is in the form of a hologram or some other form powered by artificial intelligence, will be very human-like or sentient and display human behavior that will amaze the world. Speaking of artificial intelligence, when leaders in the field of AI are asked if it is sentient, they will simply say that it is a tool and not a creature. Here is a brief video clip.
It'll get better. I think it's important. First of all, I think it's important to understand and think about GPT-4 as a tool, not a creature, which is easy to get.
But the Apostle John recorded in the Bible that image of the beast will come alive, and that means it will display human-like behavior. It will display the nature of the beast. In computer scientist jargon, when a machine reaches a point that it displays human-like behavior that is indistinguishable from human, then it is said to have passed the Turing test. That test is named after the British mathematician, logician, and computer scientist who was one of the early pioneers of artificial intelligence in the 1950s. He is best known for cracking the Enigma code that the Germans used to encrypt messages and send during World War II. By breaking that code, he was instrumental in bringing World War II to an end. I digress. Now, getting back to the Turing test, it is conducted by a human who has a conversation with a computer and another human. And if he or she cannot tell the difference between the computer using artificial intelligence and another human, then the computer is said to have passed the Turing test. Now, here is a brief video of a US senator whose voice was cloned and used to deliver a message as if it was him speaking.
The whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help me God. Thank you.
Too often, we have seen what happens when technology outpaces regulation. The unbridled exploitation of personal data, the proliferation of disinformation, and the deepening of societal inequalities. We have seen how algorithmic biases can perpetuate discrimination and prejudice, and how the lack of transparency can undermine public trust. This is not the future we want.
If you were listening from home, you might have thought that voice was mine and the words from me, but in fact, that voice was not mine. The words were not mine. And the audio was an AI voice cloning software trained on my floor speeches. The remarks were written by ChatGPT. When it was asked how I would open this hearing. And you heard just now the result. The audio and my playing, it may strike you as curious or humorous, but what reverberated in my mind was, what if I had asked it, and what if it had provided an endorsement of Ukraine surrendering or Vladimir Putin's leadership? That would have been really frightening, and the prospect is more than a little scary.
The Apostle John foresaw that the image of the beast would come alive, and he recorded it in Revelation chapter 13. The implication for those who worship the image of the beast amounts to breaking God's first commandment. While some of the pioneers and leaders in the field of AI are calling for government policy and regulations to be put in place to mitigate risks from AI, they are not looking at it through the divine lens of Revelation, even though it is recorded by the Apostle John in the Bible. They are only seeing it as the sword of Damocles that is hanging over the whole of the human race. The reality is that that system will usher in the persecution of Christians. That is what the Great Tribulation is all about. Given the fact that the world has gone digital, it will be impossible to buy or sell even the basic necessities for life without being part of that system. And that is also recorded in the Bible. Clearly, the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ will never submit to such a system, and consequently, they will be severely persecuted. Of course, there will be those who will find the going too hard, and they will fall away. The obvious question is, what can be done about that beast? The short answer is nothing. Christians are called to endure the tribulation that is ahead. This is where the road forks for those who are true disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ and those who are not. I am not going to repeat myself about how Christians should prepare for the tribulation. You may want to watch earlier episodes titled Final Notice and Code Insecurity, Code Red. Those episodes are a call to Christians to be prepared for the tribulation. However, for the purpose of discussion and caution, I will now focus on the alternative path that most of the world will take. What I would like to focus on from here on in this episode is to raise other red flags, because there are those who think that they are smart enough to navigate their way, not realizing that disaster and death awaits them. The scenario that we have today is pretty much what occurred in Daniel's time. The gist of it is that King Nebuchadnezzar had a very disturbing dream. He demanded an interpretation of it. But the problem was he had forgotten his dream and wanted someone to reveal it to him and to interpret it for him. Now that was quite a strange problem to solve. As strange as it may have seemed 2,600 years ago, the situation is no different today. Like Nebuchadnezzar, governments around the world sense that there is danger on the horizon, and consequently, they do not know what to do if they do not know what it is. That is how one United States Senator by the name of Mr. John Kennedy articulated the problem of AI when he spoke to the leaders of AI in a senatorial committee meeting. He presented them with three hypotheses and then told them to imagine that they were a king or a queen for a day and asked how they would go about regulating AI. Take a listen.
Thank you all for being here. Permit me to share with you three hypotheses that I would like you to assume for the moment to be true. Hypothesis number one, many members of Congress do not understand artificial intelligence. Hypothesis number two, that absence of understanding may not prevent Congress from plunging in with enthusiasm and trying to regulate this technology in a way that could hurt this technology. Hypothesis number three that I would like you to assume. There is likely a berserk wing of the artificial intelligence community that intentionally or unintentionally could use artificial intelligence to kill all of us and hurt us the entire time that we are dying. Assume all of those to be true. Please tell me in plain English two or three reforms, regulations, if any, that you would implement if you were queen or king for a day.
The truth is, none of them know what to do because they have not yet wrapped their heads around the problem. This is when the likes of Daniel and Joseph are needed. Fortunately, we have the record of the Apostle John in the book of Revelation to go by. Now, this is where things start becoming strange. Right through history, we see Daniel's interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream being fulfilled. But with regards to these end times, Daniel wrote something very curious. Let me read it to you. And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. That was Daniel chapter 2 and verse 43. So who are the they? Who will mingle with the seed of men? Are they the Nephilim? We know that that is what happened, and we read about it in Genesis chapter 6. And that is how giants came into existence. This time around, Daniel tells us that there will be a mixing between human and what is not human. The giants that we should expect to see are intellectual ones, not necessarily physical giants. And this is why, if you are not walking in divine revelation and faith in God, you will be manipulated, you will be deceived, and you will be destroyed by them. So the question that we should be asking is, are the human governments of this world playing right into the hands of those intellectual giants without realizing it and allowing them to write the AI policies and regulation? What is being offered to unsuspecting humanity today is so tempting, and many, like Eve, will not just admire it, but receive it with both their hands. What I am referring to is transhumanism. This is my understanding of what Daniel wrote about in chapter 2 and verse 43. It is a mix of what is human, which is the human brain, and what is not human, which is an augmentation through an implant powered by artificial intelligence. Suddenly, that human being can be connected to the internet and becomes the sum total of all knowledge. This is a huge red flag. So how far away is this from becoming a reality? The answer is right now. The Food and Drug Administration in America has approved human trials in brains from Elon Musk's Neuralink company. The attractiveness of those implants is that they promise that paralyzed people will be able to walk again. It will help blind people to see. It will help the deaf to hear again. And it will even help the mute to communicate. All that sounds so miraculous. The transhumanists will tell you that through those implants, your life will be extended indefinitely. My answer, which really is a rhetorical question to such people and to such offers, is why would I want to receive an implant just to live a little longer when I know that the Lord Jesus Christ resurrected and defeated death, and that the resurrection of his disciples will happen soon, and we will receive a new body and eternal life? That offer was made 2,000 years ago. The transhumanists are 2,000 years too late, and what they have to offer is not worth it. I want to close by leaving you with this verse from Daniel to ponder on. With smooth words, meaning of flattery and praise, he will turn to godlessness those who, meaning those who are willing to disregard the covenant, the Mosaic covenant. But the people who know their God, meaning the people who are spiritually mature, will display strength and take action, which means to resist. That was Daniel chapter 11 and verse 32. Let us pray. Father God, thank you for your holy word. Thank you for the revelation in your word that we who know you will not be deceived, but we, as even as the prophet Daniel said, will do great exploits and resist evil. I pray that you would strengthen the viewer. Cause him or her to go back and read the Bible and to live by faith in the Lord Jesus, who is returning soon. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I pray. Amen.